Shading Venus, the bet to make it a planet that is, at least, explorable. So far, there has been very little detailed scientific research on the terraforming of Venus. Most articles of this type have indeed focused on Mars. However, despite this evident disproportion of attention, our species continues to nurture the inexpressible desire to make Venus, if not habitable, at least visitable. Or at any rate, it does not give up on finding a way to make the surface of a planet that we feel is much more suited to our needs than Mars accessible to exploration, even for short periods. Mars is a very beautiful world, but irreparably small, with weak gravity and therefore unable to retain a stable atmosphere. As for Venus, we do not dare to think of complete terraforming, which would involve a crazy expense and a wait of thousands of years. All we ask is to be able to descend and work on the planet without the need for protective devices, such as spacesuits or oxygen supplies. And this, as we are about to learn, might perhaps be done in a very short time. But in the end, why should we need to access the surface of Venus? Perhaps out of sympathy for an affinity of size, gravity, and landscape. And perhaps also because we do not resign ourselves to the fact that such a beautiful and nearby planet could have been made uninhabitable by an intangible event like its atmosphere. In practice, we feel that we can't free the planet from the straitjacket it has been forced into by the malevolent spell of the greenhouse effect. To succeed, however, we absolutely need to know more. But with the current conditions of its surface, any scientific investigation of its internal geology would be hindered by temperature, pressure, and the acidic chemical environment. Practically, we are in the condition of a doctor who cannot personally visit a patient suffering from an unknown pathology. Radar maps from orbit do not tell us everything we need to know about geological activity on Venus. We know nothing about any seismic activity on Venus, and after probably a billion years of very high temperatures, even the minerals that make up its surface should be very different from those we have on Earth. It's also likely that there are active volcanoes on Venus, and geologists would like to know if there are active tectonic plates, or if the volcanoes are instead the result of more hotspots or mantle plumes. But how do we do it? There are therefore multiple possible and practical reasons why we would like to be able to descend to the surface. Not to colonize permanently, but only to explore and study. In this exciting video, as always made for you by Insane Curiosity Channel, we will have the opportunity to understand if there really is a way, as someone suggests, to quickly tame perhaps the harshest feature of all the planet's environmental characteristics, its temperature. There is no beating around the bush. Venus is a hellish place. How else would you describe a planet whose average temperature is 460 degrees Celsius and whose atmospheric pressure is 93 times that of Earth? If that's not enough, add the wind blowing at 350 kilometers per hour, air composed of 93% carbon dioxide and sulfuric acid rain. Yet Venus wasn't always such an inhospitable place. According to scientists, the climate was once much cooler, and there were numerous liquid oceans on the planet's surface. However, a few billion years ago, Venus underwent a massive greenhouse effect that changed it forever, reducing it to the decidedly life-unfriendly conditions it is in today. But how could such a thing happen? According to a new study conducted by an international team of scientists, it might have been the presence of the ocean itself that drastically altered its condition. Let's go in order. Besides being extremely hot, Venus experiences almost no temperature variation, mainly due to its very low rotation. While Earth completes a rotation on its axis in about 24 hours, Venus takes the equivalent of 243 Earth days. Not only that, Venus rotates in the opposite direction to Earth, and most other planets. Scientists suspect that things weren't always this way and that Venus once rotated in the opposite direction and at a much higher speed, a crucial element for the presence of the ocean. A gigantic asteroid impact might have changed everything, influencing planetary dynamics to the point of slowing down and then reversing the rotation. However, the scientists who conducted the study believe it might have been the ocean itself that caused all this. The tides would have acted as a brake on the planet's rotation due to the friction generated between tidal currents and the seabed. The same thing, in fact, happens on Earth, but according to calculations, this mechanism changes the length of the day by only 20 seconds every million years or so. And on Venus, scientists conducted a series of simulations, discovering that the tides could have slowed the planet's rotation by up to 72 Earth days every million years. A reduction in speed sufficient to cause the evaporation of Venus's oceans, triggering the greenhouse effect that gradually deprived it of its potential habitability. All this could have happened in a relatively short time, between 10 and 50 million years. The fact is that our twin planet seems to have been definitively conquered by the dark side of the Force, and nothing over there seems to be going right. Just think about this. Between its slow retrograde rotation and the fact that Venus takes almost 225 days to orbit the Sun, a single solar day on Venus lasts 116.75 days. This means that for an observer on the surface of Venus, it takes almost 4 months for the Sun to set and rise again, compared to 24 hours here on Earth. As if that weren't enough, Venus is also isothermal, meaning it experiences virtually no temperature variation between its day-night hemispheres. This is due to its dense atmosphere, but also its slow rotation and low axial tilt, 3 degrees compared to Earth's 23.5 degrees, which essentially means that Venus does not experience seasons or anything we might consider a day-night cycle. Before moving on, don't forget to subscribe to our channel if you haven't already. Make sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss out on our daily videos. In short, given this seemingly completely compromised situation, what still convinces us of the possibility of successfully intervening in the Venusian environment? Well, to understand this, it would be better to first take a quick historical review. The first method proposed to terraform Venus was developed in 1961 by Carl Sagan. In an article titled "The Planet Venus," he advocated the use of genetically modified bacteria to transform the carbon in the atmosphere into organic molecules. However, this was rendered impractical due to the subsequent discovery of sulfuric acid in Venus's clouds and the effects of the solar wind. In his 1991 study, Terraforming Venus Quickly, British scientist Paul Birch proposed instead to bombard Venus's atmosphere with a huge amount of hydrogen, which reacting with carbon dioxide would produce elemental carbon, graphite, and water through the Bosch reaction. However, it would take an enormous amount of hydrogen to convert the entire Venusian atmosphere, and Birch suggested that it could be obtained from gas giants or the ice of their moons. Another idea is to bombard Venus with refined magnesium and calcium, which would sequester the carbon in the form of calcium and magnesium carbonates. In their 1996 article, "The Stability of Climate on Venus," Mark Bullock and David H. Grinspoon of the University of Colorado at Boulder indicated that Venus's deposits of calcium and magnesium oxides could be used for this process. Through mining, these minerals could be exposed on the surface, thus acting as carbon sinks. However, Bullock and Grinspoon also argue that this would have a limited cooling effect to about 127 degrees Celsius or 260 degrees Fahrenheit, and would reduce atmospheric pressure to only about 43 bar, half of Venus's current pressure. Therefore, additional supplies of calcium and magnesium would be needed to obtain the 8×10^20 kilogram of calcium or 5×10^20 kilogram of magnesium required, which would most likely have to be extracted from asteroids. But all these proposals, based on chemical seeding of the atmosphere, were soon abandoned, buried, if nothing else, by the unappealable force of numbers. Venusian carbon dioxide, in fact, is about one-third the mass of all the Earth's ocean water. Whatever way you tackle the problem, whether physical removal or chemical interaction, it would be an incredibly energy and cost-intensive process, and would probably take an extremely long time to have an effect. However, if we give up the forbidden dream of complete terraforming, it seems that something better can be achieved. And with this, we have reached the focal point of our narrative. For some years now, the simplest and most immediate idea has been gaining ground among planetologists, if one wants to answer the question, how to lower the temperature of a body subjected to the heat of the sun. By shading it, of course. And so the project of an enormous sunshade placed in space, capable of completely shielding the planet, is formed. Let's start right away with an objection, the first of many. Okay, but where to put it? To shade Venus more effectively, the structure cannot simply orbit around Venus, but must be positioned exactly between the Sun and Venus at a point where the gravitational forces of the Sun and Venus are equal and allow the structure to roughly maintain the same position. Fortunately, this point exists, and it's called the Lagrangian point L1, located about 1 million kilometers from Venus in the direction of the Sun. It involves launching part of the structure from Earth, or better, from the Moon, and then completing it in space working directly at the L1 point. I have seen figures indicating that solar sails could eventually be manufactured in space with thicknesses ranging from 0.2 to 5 microns, where a micron is 1/1000th of a millimeter. This thickness of the metal layer is on the order of the size of bacteria and will require very advanced equipment to manufacture on site. It could weigh only 0.1 grams per square meter up to about 1.0 grams per square meter with plastic support. All these thin layers must be completely resistant to ultraviolet rays. We can assume that the sunshade would be made of material similar to that of solar sails already in use, probably using materials of asteroid origin. The typical design of such a fabric has a polymer layer that supports a metallic film layer capable of reflecting much of the sunlight back towards the sun. The material would likely need to be reinforced with heavier fibers at intervals to prevent tears from meteoroid impacts, and possibly with heavier open reinforcement beams to keep the entire sunshade relatively flat and properly oriented. Other options include having the sunshade rotate to keep it relatively flat. The metallic film layer must be thick enough to prevent significant amounts of sunlight from penetrating through the ultra-thin film. But how big should this sunshade be? Well, it's just a matter of geometry. Venus has a diameter of about 12,100 kilometers. A complete sunshade must be wider than the planet it is shading, as the Sun is not a point source of light. A rough estimate of a reasonable diameter for the sunshade would be about 15,000 kilometers wide, with an area of about 175 million square kilometers. This would provide about 1,500 kilometers of shadow margin on each side of the planet. Mind-boggling numbers, especially if we start imagining the weight of such a structure. There are various estimates, but reasonably, the resulting mass could not be less than 100 million tons. As if we weren't already in the realm of hard science fiction, there would also be the major problem of stabilizing the sunshade at the Lagrangian point L1. It is true that celestial mechanics assures us that in that region, any object, whether an asteroid or a spaceship, would remain in gravitational equilibrium. But in the case of a sunshade, we must consider that solar pressure would act on what is effectively a sail, causing the entire structure to drift. Therefore, the actual position must balance gravity with light pressure. To this end, the structure will need to be equipped with large inclined segments, capable of slowing down or speeding up its velocity in its solar orbit. Okay, having gotten this far, let's assume everything works properly, and the sunshade manages to cover the entire planet, plunging it into the deepest shadow. What would happen at that point? Apparently, calculations ensure that after about 100 years, the temperature of Venus would drop to 31 degrees Celsius or 87 degrees Fahrenheit. At this temperature, known as the critical point of carbon dioxide, part of the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere would begin to condense from gas to liquid, and the low-lying areas of Venus's surface would start to be covered by seas and oceans of liquid carbon dioxide, much like much of Earth's surface is covered by seas and oceans of water. As it is condensed into liquid, the amount of carbon dioxide remaining in the atmosphere would begin to decrease, and with it, the atmospheric pressure. Eventually, the temperature would drop to the freezing point of carbon dioxide, minus 57 degrees, and the seas, oceans, and lakes of liquid carbon dioxide would begin to freeze. much of the remaining carbon dioxide in the atmosphere would fall as snow. This entire cooling process would take no more than a couple of centuries from start to finish. Once completed, the next step would be to ensure that when the shade is removed, allowing the planet to warm up, the frozen carbon dioxide would not be released back into the atmosphere. One way to achieve this would be to cover the oceans of frozen carbon dioxide with an insulating material and provide some sort of refrigeration system to keep them cool. Once the carbon dioxide is securely trapped, the sunshade could be removed to allow the planet to warm up again. Since almost all the carbon dioxide would have been removed from the atmosphere, it would no longer provide such a powerful greenhouse gas. The goal for the first cooling phase is minus 56 degrees Celsius or minus 68.8 degrees Fahrenheit, near the triple point of carbon dioxide. At lower temperatures, CO2 is always in a solid state. Only at the so-called triple point do all three phases, solid, liquid, and gas, coexist simultaneously. The final target temperature should probably be around minus 80 degrees Celsius, which is the point at which carbon dioxide would remain frozen, except in volcanic areas. At the end of this phase, the overall temperature reduction on Venus's surface from 462 degrees Celsius to minus 80 degrees Celsius would be as much as 542 degrees Celsius. Experts assure us that the time for complete condensation would be more than 127 years, and probably less than 200 years. Not very long then. The full operation of the sunshade would be maintained nominally until the temperature near the surface reached about minus 80 degrees Celsius. At that point, most of the boiling of carbon dioxide would have stopped, except directly over volcanic vents, and enough sunlight would be allowed to stabilize the temperature. The amount of sunlight allowed through would probably be comparable to about 10% of full sun on Venus, about half the sunlight received on Mars, and similar to that received by main belt asteroids. After this process is completed, the screen could be removed or openings could be made, allowing the planet to partially warm up again to temperatures comfortable for life on Earth. A source of hydrogen or water would still be needed, and part of the remaining 3.5 bar of atmospheric nitrogen would need to be fixed in the soil. Birch suggests breaking up an icy moon of Saturn, such as Hyperion, and bombarding Venus with its fragments. Birch made it sound simple, but we must not forget that even if we managed to achieve everything stated in this brief conversation, there would still be countless and serious problems to overcome to achieve a semblance of terraforming. There is especially the absence of a magnetic field, which is concerning, perhaps linked to the very slow rotation that prevents the start of a dynamo effect. And then there is the issue of water, an element that Venus is currently completely devoid of, and which a planet oriented towards environmental recovery cannot do without. But all in all, as we said at the beginning, our goal in building the solar screen was not to terraform the planet to favor mass colonization, but only to ensure that a few teams of explorers could descend to the surface and work safely. Does it seem difficult? Does it seem complicated? I can't blame you, but my advice is to think of Venus as a valuable real estate investment. We know that the land could be transformed into a wonderful home and the property value would skyrocket, but we are talking about a huge commitment in terms of money and time before that can happen. In the meantime, the best we can do is to move some people into the antechamber of the existing structure. Naturally, if we are willing to think in terms of the long term and assume that humanity has an interplanetary future, there is no reason to suppose that we will not eventually make Venus and Mars second homes for humanity. To use the usual old metaphor, we can buy the house next door to renovate and gradually bring it to the point where it is fully furnished. Then we can turn our attention and efforts to the lot to be demolished on the other side and renovated, turning it into a third beautiful home for us and our children. Once people have moved in, we can rest assured that if one of the houses were to burn down, it would not take us all with it.